Hi, everybody. So we're going to begin with, you are all going to chant something. Okay, can you read that? Okay, everyone chant. Okay, in Sanskrit, Bhagavati Prajna Paramita, come on. In Sanskrit, Prajna Bhagavati Prajna Paramita Hridaya. In Tibetan, Chomden Dema Sherab Parchin Yingbo. In English, Blessed Lady Buddha, Transcendent Wisdom Heart. Thus did I hear on a special occasion, the Blessed Lord was dwelling on the Vulture Peak at Rajagriha, together with the great communities of mendicants and bodhisattvas. At that time, the Blessed Lord entranced himself in the teaching samadhi called Illumination of the Profound. Just then, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, was contemplating the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, and he realized that those five body-mind processes are void of any intrinsic reality. Thereupon, impelled by the power of the Buddha, Venerable Shariputra addressed the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, thus, when any noble son wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, how should he learn? Then the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, addressed the Venerable Sharadatiputra thus, Shariputra, when any noble son or noble daughter wishes to engage in the practice of the profound transcendence of wisdom, he or she should realize it in this way. Those five body-mind processes should be truly realized to be void of any intrinsic reality. Matter is voidness, voidness is matter, voidness is not other than matter, neither is matter other than voidness. Likewise, sensations, conceptions, mental functions, and consciousnesses are also void. Shariputra, thus all things are voidness, signless, uncreated, unceased, stainless, impeccable, undecreased, and unincreased. Shariputra, thus in voidness there are no matter, no sensation, no conception, no mental function, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mentality, no form or color, no sound, no scent, no taste, no texture, no idea. There are no sense media from eye to mentality, sense media. And there are no consciousness media from visual to mental consciousness media either. There are no ignorance and no cessation of ignorance and so on up to no old age and death and no cessation of old age and death either. Likewise, there are no suffering, no origination, no cessation, no path, no intuitive wisdom, no attainment and no non-attainment either. Therefore, Shariputra, because the Bodhisattva is without attainment, she lives in reliance on transcendent wisdom. His spirit is unobscured and free of fear. Passing far beyond all confusion, she ultimately succeeds in nirvana. And all the Buddhas who live in past, present, and future rely on transcendent wisdom to reach manifestly perfect Buddhahood in unexcelled perfect enlightenment. Such being so, there is the mantra of transcendent wisdom, the mantra of great science, the unexcelled mantra, the uniquely universal mantra, the mantra that eradicates all suffering. It is not false and should be known as truth, the transcendent wisdom mantra, as follows tadyata. Om gate gate paragate parasam gate bodhi swaha. Om gate gate paragate parasam gate bodhi swaha. Om gate gate paragate parasam gate bodhi swaha. Shariputra, thus should the Bodhisattva, the great hero, learn the profound transcendence of wisdom. Thereupon the Blessed Lord arose from that samadhi and applauded the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero. Excellent, excellent, noble son. So it is, so it is. One should practice the profound transcendence of wisdom in just the way you have taught it. And even the transcendent Buddhas will joyfully congratulate you. When the Blessed Lord had spoken thus, the Venerable Sharadatiputra, the noble Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, the great hero, and everyone in that audience and the whole world with its gods, humans, titans, and fairies rejoiced and all applauded what the Buddha said. Very good. Okay, so now we are going to, never mind all this, don't even worry about it. We are going to the psychonauts. Yes, we're going because we're in Tantra, you know. So now let me remind you that this course, this long course that we have done, and unfortunately I was off and away, but also other good people were here. Anyway, this is about the Dalai Lama's force for good. And this force for good, I have all so many spare parts, you know, so I have to fit all together. Okay. And so, you know, and the whole point of himself in the force for good is making the Buddhist discoveries about the mind and about reality available to everyone, whether they're Buddhist or not. So as the author of the book, who wrote it for His Holiness Dan Goldman, told me when I told him about it, he said the point about the force for good is to do these things without them being Buddhism. So I, you know, the course was entitled The Buddhist Sources. So now, in the last session, Tom and I were with you, and then tonight, we're on the subject of Tantra. And I entitled them by the name of three of the most important Tantras. And but that doesn't mean that we're now going to do Buddhism, because we're doing the force for good. So we're looking at the Buddhist sources. And in among the things that the force for good does, in what way are the Tantras the Buddhist sources? In other words, that's where I'm trying to start today. I would call it Buddhist neuroscience, basically. And it is the province of these people who I call the psychonauts, who are the Mahāsiddhas, the great adepts, and their yogic texts and arts, technologies and arts. And this is where they deal with the brain, but not just the brain in the head, the brain throughout the entire body. And they deal with the brain in order to develop the cultivation of love, compassion, joy, and equilibrium, in order to develop the art of lucid sleeping, lucid dreaming, and lucid awakening, no longer unenlightened sleepwalking. Oh, I like that. The art of positive reimagining, creatively sustaining environment, reinforcing societies, and the art of conscious evolution, controlled traversal of death, lucid dying, and voluntary reincarnating. So that's it, and then this is very important, the schema, which we will talk about, and some of you, if you have trouble seeing it, if you're online, and welcome everyone who's online, if you have the introduction to my Book of the Dead translation, you have some tables in there, and these are pretty much the same as some of those tables. And so this is surprising that without all the machinery of electron microscopes and, you know, MRIs and fMRIs and all this kind of thing, and EEGs, that the Buddhists themselves were working with the brain, actually. And all of these things that have been discovered, like neuroplasticity, due to the Dalai Lama's dialogue with the different scientists, or in the same time as the Dalai Lama's dialogue with Richard Davidson and other neuroscientists. And also, Davidson's work about how compassion meditation actually changes the circulation and circuitry in the brain, and combine that with neuroplasticity, and if you meditate on certain, not just meditate period, but you meditate on certain themes in certain ways, this then affects the way the brain is organized. And they are not even beginning to get into the overall body, not just the brain itself, but the overall central nervous system of the whole body, which is the chakra system of the Buddhist. And I'll just jump ahead of this. You have, like, this is a foreigner's, you know, an Australian artist, his depiction of what the two right and left channels and the central channel sort of look like. You notice that in her head, you have the left nostril has this white channel, The right nostril has a red channel on the other side, and in the middle is a sort of purplish-blue channel, which begins at where the third eye begins, in the center of the forehead, but at the back of where the back of the two nasal passages, and then goes down in between the two of them, and it goes down. This is not complete, but that's just an impression of it. And then this is a Tibetan medical depiction of this central nervous system, and with the blue channel going all the way down, straight down the center, the right red one and the left white one looping like that, but looping around the central channel and actually knotting it off at various levels, which is the way in the normal person that it occurs, and therefore the central channel for the normal person doesn't really have a great deal of energy, although especially at the heart chakra, where there is a sixfold knot, which is at this level, you know, at the heart chakra of that, I guess you can see, well, you have this bright light. I don't really need the bright light on me. Or maybe you do for the people, but I don't know if you can see it clearly, but the heart chakra is much more complex, and because it has a triple knot, sixfold knot, actually, three times the right one, the red one, and three times the left one. And in the center of the heart chakra is where one's super subtle mind is located. You know, the super subtle body mind is located. And that's another reason this is probably esoteric, because, you know, Buddha makes a big thing about selflessness in the exoteric teaching. And the super subtle body mind is kind of like a soul, actually. It's the super subtle self. Although, the selflessness is only a fixed and unchanging thing. All of the things, all of the body and mind parts or ways of looking at it, whatever they are, they're all completely process elements. You know, they're not like unchanging thing. There's no unchanging thing going on at all. So that's what we're doing with the tantra. And why are we doing that? Remember, when you take a bodhisattva vow, when you conceive the spirit of enlightenment, the bodhicitta, in other words, conceiving it means you get the idea suddenly that you are an evolutionary being and that there's no limit to your evolution, and your evolution can go negative or positive over endless future lives, and that it's possible that it can go to the supremely positive, which is Buddhahood, and not only possible, but given infinite time, you know, I guess one could waste one's time infinitely, too. But it's really very unlikely that one would, especially if encouraged by one of the things that one needs to conceive the spirit of enlightenment, which is one needs to encounter an enlightened being in some way. You know, encounter one like in the lifetime of the Buddha, that would be encountering Shakyamuni Buddha, or even some of the arhats who were already pretty enlightened, in the terms of later times, they were always great enlightened masters. In the modern period, it's very difficult, but you can also encounter a Buddha in a text through a book, you know, with your imagination. You can encounter in a dream, etc. But it's considered that you really have to have an encounter with some sort of a higher type of being that you sort of subliminally sense is this higher type of being. You sort of feel that, and it must be there. Like when I met my original teacher, I just knew there was something about him that I had to study with him, and I had to find out what it was that he thought I might be able to learn. And then someone asked me, like, well, you just met him. He's like this humble guy in a little house in New Jersey. You know, like, you've just been in India and you're going back to India. Why are you saying now he's your teacher and throwing away your ticket and everything? And I said, well, I know he's there because he can help me. Well, why do you think so? I said, well, because he doesn't have any use for me himself, I said. And he said, what do you mean? How do you know that? And I said, well, he's not really even there, I said. Although he was very much there. He was serving tea, and he was telling me I couldn't get enlightened because I was an idiot, and probably unless I learned to shape up, and all kinds of, I mean, he was very manifesting. But I sensed that, you know, because I'd met a lot of gurus by then, and not just all Buddhists, in other parts of the world at that time. And one thing about some kinds of holy people is that you feel that they're huge beings and they're sort of very full there, and they're there, you know what I mean? And you're sort of off on the corner because they're so there, you know. Whereas this guy wasn't there at all. I sensed, but I didn't know what I was talking about, of course. I had no idea, but subliminally, it just came spurting out of me, which I learned that he was aware of his selflessness in that sense, you know, and he didn't want to put me in his Dharma center business, you know, the way all the lamas and gurus tend to do, you know, like to join his corporation, you know. It was just really there for me in a certain way. I could sense it, you know, and that was borne out after through many years of activity with that particular gentleman, the late Dunjile Dutsene Mute Keshe Wangyal. So one meets some person like that, and then one gets the idea that it's possible to be this other kind of being that has in their own field, the centers not around a cycle of worry and anxiety and like self-awareness and self-whatever description and whatever, like maneuvering their way through a world that they're different from, but has within them a kind of well of bliss, a fountain of bliss, which is quiet and calm. It's not like exuding or oozing out of them at all. It's just there, you know, and you feel it, you know, and because it's calm, you know, and it's something different. And you feel that, and you feel you could be that. And then you can say, oh, and how do I do that? Oh, I become a bodhisattva. And then as a bodhisattva, I devote my life to all beings, and I express my interconnection with all beings from the very beginning, of being like one with them all, and that I'm doing this for all of them, as part of all of them, something like that. Bodhisattva vow is sort of like that. And it's also very practical, you know, in the sense that it can only really arise in someone who does feel connected like that and realizes they're not going to get away from all these other beings anyway. So they might as well be a Buddha. It's the only way to tolerate that situation, in fact. Right? Imagine if you never get away from anybody. Your mother-in-law, your ex, your like what, the corner policeman, whatever, the cockroach. Then the best is to be like able to tolerate it totally and happily and help them be happy, actually. So what I'm getting to with the bodhisattva, going back over the bodhisattva thing, is that then the bodhisattva says, okay, I'm ready to stay here for three incalculable aeons of lifetimes to evolve my body-mind complex, you know, life after life, endlessly, you know, and I'll give my life infinite numbers of times to every being. It will be the way where I will overcome attachment to my life, to my body, to my possessions, to my relationships, to my whatever identity, and give it away constantly, 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 and then have to be reborn and get it reattached, and then do it again, then again, again, again. So it's like one signs up. In a way, that's why you can't do it if you don't think there is a future life. There's no point to it. You don't need it. You're just not going to exist after death. So there's no point to make a big stress and strain about helping all beings, because you won't be able to if that is the case. But if you feel that it's real practical, that you're going to continue, then you might as well continue in an optimal way, is the idea. So so that's where Tantra comes in. When you do that and have that bodhisattva vow, in the Buddhist case, and you have that bodhisattva vow, and that's why actually in the theories of Tantra, there's an English scholar at Oxford who's quite bright and nice, named Alexis Sanderson. And he had a teacher in Kashmir who was a Shaiva teacher, who was a scholarly great teacher. And he gave him a lot of texts that a lot of people hadn't seen. And he read all these texts, and then he noticed, he learned Sanskrit, read all these texts. And then he noticed that a lot of passages and things in the text were similar to what's in a lot of Buddhist tantric texts, especially the Cakrasamvara Tantra. By the way, that's our topic today. You know, I wrongly had it put that I was going to do Kala Chakra today, but not. I'm doing Cakrasamvara, and next week I'm doing Kala Chakra. But you know, I'm not really covering it. I'm talking about how it is a resource of the force for good, actually, in a sort of ultimate way. You know, so I'm sorry that if you were particularly interested in Kala Chakra, that's next week. And this is, and the reason for that is that last week we talked a little bit about Guhya Samaja Tantra, which is considered by some to be the sort of foremost, what they call father tantra. And it's considered foremost father tantra. And the father is the compassion embodiment side of things. And therefore, it particularly relates to practices that are connected to the magic body or the illusion body, as people rudely call it. And I correctly call it the magic body, the Maya Deha. And that's the way in which you rehearse becoming a Buddha in a sort of meditationally conceived and developed dream body, dreamlike body, which for which you use your visualization, stabilized visualization that you have done in the creation stage, where you have learned to be able to re-envision yourself as, you know, a Vajra Yogini or a Cakrasamvara or some, so you know, Avalokiteshvara, Manjushri, whatever particular Buddha deity form you have chosen, or you know, that you have learned to visualize yourself as. And then in this state of the magic body, very advanced state, it's like you're in, the world is like a dream, and you actually feel you're in such a body, and then you can actually do things in such a body, like a controlled lucid dream sort of thing, but a dream in a special sort of situation, which I'll try to explain. So that's the father tantra. And then the Cakrasamvara is the supreme of the mother tantras. And the mother is the clear light, the immersion in the clear light. She is the ultimate reality, clear light, or transparency. The word light is a little misleading, because it's a kind of a light that one has never seen, because it has no opposite of darkness. And therefore, transparency is actually the best translation for it. And its analogy is the gray pre-dawn twilight, where you can see your hand, but you can't see the lines on the palm of your hand. So gray is like a mixture of black and white, right? But it's not a dull gray like that. It's a lucid, luminous, transparent gray. You know, I mean, is glass, inside glass, is it gray? No, not really. It's just transparent, you know. And if other light shines, then it reflects, it allows that other light to go through it. But it's sort of the deepest form of light or something like that. So they still do call it Prabhasvara, you know, clear light, light clear. But Prabha means light. But they specify it's not sunlight or moonlight, which are the two bright phases of the subtle mind. Okay, so that's this, and then the Kala Chakra is a subcategory of the Mother Tantra that has some very special, wonderful qualities that we will talk more about next week, and that I'm always talking about. It's Holiness is always talking about. It's a really special thing. But it is itself within the Mother Tantra category, that it is a more clear light thing. That's why the palette in the mandala of the mother of the Kala Chakra is very pastel type of color. It's very special. Okay, but anyway, I'm talking about Cakrasamvara, Mother Tantra in general. So now let's look at this schema. In the schema of the psychonauts, this business here is the coarse body mind. Right, which is of course flesh and blood, or sometimes they call the coarse body mind. They refer to it as the six sense organs, meaning because the skin is a sense organ, and the eyes, the ear, the nose, the mouth, the tongue. You know, these are sense organs. So that is what the coarse body is, and then the coarse mind is the sixfold consciousness that aligns itself with any of the six senses, and the sixth sense is technically not really physical. The sixth sense is the mental sense, which is very explained in a very complicated way in Buddhist epistemology and psychology, so we don't need to worry about it. But basically, it's the inner mind that pays attention to this or that sense thing, usually, and can also go into inner realms using imagination and so on. It's the sixth sense. And that's the mental sense. And its sense is not technically physical, it's temporal. The sense faculty, in other words, like the visual consciousness uses the eye sense organ and the visual object, but the mental sense consciousness doesn't have an actual organ. It's the previous moments of the other organs, something like that, of the other awarenesses. It's complicated, so I don't want to get into it, but just that's what our normal consciousness is, and actually most of us are mostly usually our waking time is spent in the five sense consciousnesses, because we're always reacting to sense stimuli. Then the subtle body mind is this chakra system, which is composed of za, lung, tigle, you know, nadi, prana, or vayu, and bindu in Sanskrit, or za, lung, tigle in Tibetan, which mean channels, which are nerves, nerve channel, energies. It's called wind, but wind, do you need a chair back there? You have one?
Yes, thanks.
Okay. And I saw someone standing. So the channels, which are the, they say 72,000 nerve channels, which stem out of a kind of tree-like central axial channel with two right and left companion axial channels. There are actually more, but the most important ones are two. And then with the different ganglia or complexes, they usually use five, the brain, the throat, the heart, the navel, and the genital chakra. And then sometimes there are intermediate ones, because the chakras, in a way, are programming. They're software, they're structuring. They're not actually, in other words, if you dissect somebody, you're not going to find the heart chakra. You're going to find the heart, and you're going to find a lot of nerves around that heart, and in and around the spine and so on, and in the center of the body at that level. But you're not going to find like a beautiful umbrella with eight spokes and a pet lotus petal and things like that. You won't find. It's just wetware, or I call it slimeware, actually, the nervous system. But anyway, the subtle body mind, so that's the physical body, the neural channels, energies, and neurotransmitters, which are the bindu, which are these chemicals in the, like adrenochrome and you know, serotonin, all this kind of thing. All of those are neurotransmitters. And then the subtle mind is three states of luminance. And they are, the first one is like a inner experience of being a realm of empty space that the mind has, that you can reach through meditation also, and you go through when you die, and actually very quickly when you fall asleep, although you don't notice it usually, or when you faint and lose consciousness. So there's a layer of sort of moonlight space, not a moon, but just moonlit space, like a white light space. Then there's a reddish light, hot solar space, very brilliant hot space. And then there's a dark space that's a brilliant darkness, so sort of like a shiny black, if you can imagine. And those three realms, I call them luminance, radiance, and immanence. And they are considered knowledges or intuitions. And they are just direct experiences of those three things. So in other words, when you're fully in your own central nervous system, you are just that kind of spatial consciousness. And that is why, for example, in Guhyasamaja, and in many of, you know, he has three faces, which are blackish, black, red, and white, white and red, in a different order than you'd expect, but there are three colors. And that means that that's one reason, that's a clue as to why they say Guhyasamvara is the best of the father tantras, connected with the magic body. Because if you can become conscious at the subtle mind level of yourself as those sort of three awarenesses of those three luminosities, and yet they are your sort of mind, then the energy flows within your nervous system are in a perfect balance. And you are able to consciously arise toward the more coarse matter, and shape that coarse matter according to your mind. So is the idea. So that's why the faces are the colors of those subtle states in a certain way. They symbolize that to the person. And Cakrasamvara, for example, has a black similar. The front face is also black, and then the right face is yellow, golden actually, and the back is red and the left is green. So it's a different kind of order of things. Kalachakra again has black and red and white and yellow in the back. So Kalachakra is even different. And those are all having to do with different ways you're sort of dealing with your subtle mind in a way, with those faces, what they mean, you know. It's very interesting. And I mean, even just imagine yourself right now, you're looking at me with two eyes, those of you who are not asleep already. And yet imagine if you had three eyes in each face and you were four of them, and what would be being transmitted into your brain, you know, like stimuli from four directions of quite a lot of visual stimuli, sort of all of light would be coming into your brain, your brain would be handling it and have to restructure itself in order to do that, if you can imagine that. Which you do when you practice the creation states. You do that kind of imagination. And then when you do that, then that does restructure your brain. Anyway, without consciously sort of going directly into the brain, just by feeling that the brain is issuing forth in different sense faculties, put it that way. So then the super subtle body-mind, this is the big one. And this one, in a way, is beyond conception. You'll see soon when you see how it's defined. The body are the super subtle physical energies. They're still called wind, but a subtle wind, because wind just means wind in the Buddhist thing doesn't mean the breeze blowing. If you feel breeze on your face, there are also atoms in the old Buddhist idea. There's earth elements. Any sort of solidity of touch that's earth. And any sense of cohesiveness is water, and any warmth is fire, and the movement itself is the wind, that's all, just the movement. So it really means energy, you know, a vayu in that case, you know, it does. And there's, you know, none of those elements, those are just sort of, therefore, abstract forces or something like that, or qualities. And they're always combined, actually, in any actual physical object. And so, so the super subtle one is still called wind because it's motion, it's energy. But it is, it actually is not dividable from clear light, bliss void mind, which is the subtle, super subtle mind. And that, when you withdraw to, you know, when you meditate, like there are meditations where you have body mandalas. Like when you say you're Guru Samaja, then however you have a body mandala of the whole mandala building with 32 deities in the Akshobhyavajra version of Guru Samaja, for example, where you have a body mandala in a tiny little drop the size of a split pea, or even of a mustard seed. Well, the main deity is the size of a mustard seed, but then the whole mandala is like the size of a pea. And then you develop a kind of imaginative microscope where you visualize all those deities at that size, and yet through meditative stabilization, you can actually see them at that size. So it's the way your mind goes down into like micro size, and something like that, if you follow me. And the building is tiny, et cetera, like this. And then there's a thing where you draw from that, and then make it big, and then fuse it with the big one outside, you know, which is also you. I mean, this is just really, it really requires incredible meditative ability to do these things, which I don't pretend to have, but at least I respect and because I've studied what they are, and on the other hand, at the super subtle level, so therefore going to the super subtle, you're going down and you're sort of going into the micro realm, and withdrawing from the coarse reality entirely, and even the subtle reality, you're going to the super subtle. But when you reach the clear light mind, the clear light mind is everywhere. It's infinite. It's the Buddha mind. It's no different from Buddha's mind, the clear light mind. The difference from a Buddha, we all have the same minds, therefore, as the Buddha, in this kind of technical way of putting it. It's so brilliant, you know, scientifically. We all have it, but our problem is we're not aware of these other levels of our mind. We're completely engaged in this coarse level only, where we're the separate being with things and our senses are like fending them off or experiencing them or looking at them. And these other things we go back into when we sleep, when we die, and when we have orgasm, when we faint, when we pass out, when we yawn a little bit even. The yawning exercise is bringing energy into the center of the subtle thing. But normally, otherwise, we're completely unaware of that. You know, it's barred from us. And then the reason we die when we get down to the clear light, when we disidentify from all the coarse thing, the reason it's called death is because in that, at that moment, one is on the very brink of infinity. So it skitters away from being connected to a finite thing, if you follow me. But what skitters away? Ignorance maintains a super subtle form of being separate, if you follow me. So therefore, that the super subtle form just shoots right across that infinity experience and immediately looks to find a way of being separate from everything and, like, you know, maneuver through it. So it then shapes the, it shapes, you know, what sort of a embodiment that would seem to be separate you want, depending on what you've been attracted to in your previous life. And, you know, you to be born as a human or to be born as something. But again, it's across a barrier of complete unconsciousness. And so it's like in a dream where you have no control over what might happen to you if you're not, if you haven't explored that, if you follow me. So it's no wonder, even though in Buddhist cultures, people were not necessarily, very few were aware of this sort of esoteric level. And in some of the Buddhist countries, they don't even have it anymore. Although actually, like the most orthodox Sri Lanka Buddhist community in the second millennium had Tantra, and they had the esoteric teaching and the Mahayana teaching for up until around 950 or so of the Common Era. So for the first, you know, 1300 years that they had Buddhism, they had the full package, let's call it, you know. And but then they sort of reverted back to just, oh, we don't want that stuff, and then they forgot about it. But what I'm saying, that Buddhists who have this sense, they get very concerned to use their life. That's why then there are so many meditation centers in these cultures. There are so many people who become, you know, academics, which means monks and nuns, you know, academic in the sense of living on alms, low salary, but enough to be alive so they can study, because they're not doing regular, like, you know, productive work in the sense of materially or economically productive. And because they are very concerned that they must become aware of more layers and levels of their conscience. And that's why in Buddhist psychology, the unconscious is not an absolute thing. In other words, it's there for the ordinary sleepwalking person, but the enlightened person becomes aware, conscious of the unconscious. So the task is to become fully aware of your unconscious, actually. And that's considered dangerous, you know, so that's why that's also esoteric, because you're going into the unconscious, you know. So, you know, if the academia, for example, if our modern liberating or liberal education really was out to produce, to graduate, you had to become somewhat enlightened, then it would be there, then the core curriculum would have mandatory psychotherapy for everyone in the. And it would be, of course, this kind of psychotherapy, becoming self-aware at a deep level. That would be mandatory, part of the curriculum. So you couldn't graduate unless you were somewhat less of a psycho than the people who hadn't gone to that school. rather than a more clever psycho than other people, which unfortunately is what we have been producing. You know, like a Ted Cruz type, or you know, I have a plan, you know, never mind. No, I know how to take away everybody's social security. Or Paul Ryan or some complete loony. Okay, so that's the super subtle body-mind idea. It's really very, very amazing idea, you know. And that's why, you know, I never say supernatural anything that happens in Buddhism, you know, or in the world. They're super normal, but not supernatural, because nature includes this really area where the mind is really powerful. And it isn't that everything just is the mind. In a way, at this super subtle level, you could say everything is mind, because body and mind are the same. That is to say, the wind energies, the physical, you know, because we have BM here, BM in this table, BM. But this bottom BM, body-mind, is just because of, like in our binary way of thinking about something, because you're coming at it from a physical and mental. But they say they're one thing. And His Holiness, in the talks with the scientists, I've been begging His Holiness and various people in the dialogue to please let the Western materialist scientists know that the Buddhists don't mind materialistic reductionism. I mean, theoretically, no. They do know by the way the Dalai Lama behaves, but they've been hiding this because it's secret. You know, it's esoteric in a way, although it's known, it's published, but still people don't get it. Because like you say, body and mind. So you think, oh yeah, okay, there's that body-mind duality, physical-mental duality, even down to super subtle level. But no, there isn't. Because the clear light of the void and the mind of bliss that is one with the clear light of the void are one thing, you know, and the energies of it. And then that's also, it's further paradoxical and inconceivable, like the quantum people have this idea of the infinite mathematically traced infinite energy of the vacuum, that a perfect vacuum has infinite energy. But, and the reason that there's no motion in it, like energy as motion, is that everything is already done. So there, it's completely quiescent, but can be drawn from infinitely, you know? And it's like that thing, they collide, they have this black hole idea, where everything just goes into it, nothing can come out of it. But obviously, the universe is not a black hole, because we're here. So that means that they have then those ideas of pulsar, you know, then light comes shooting out of it, or there's explosions or something. They get all, no one can deal with it. But, and they feel that's a problem, because they can't deal with the fact that you can't deal with reality ultimately in some neat formulaic way anyway. They don't like, you know, they are not content with that. So they keep looking. But it's in that same area, you know. So the clear light of the void, which is not a light, and it's not a darkness, and it is infinite energy, and but it doesn't do anything. And our mind is one with it, and everything is made of it. And it is the deepest nature of everything. And if you know that, you're really happy. Except you're not happy because the only way you know it is to melt into it through bliss. And when you melt into it through bliss, you feel you are everybody else. And then since you are them and they're not happy, you're still not quite happy. So you could, unless you make them happy. So then you become automatic make them happy machine. That's what a Buddha is, right? Because they're really not them to you even, in a way. They are, they aren't to like everything. So you can't make it fall down on either side of anything. Right? You got that? You look. She looks, she says, yeah, I do. But because you have melted into this infinity blissfully, you can bear that being aware that they are not happy. And therefore, you're inexhaustible in your ability and skill to help them become happy. And not only that, then there's the other element that we can console ourselves with is the time element. You're also infinite in time, not just in space. So you can see the optimal path for them to become where they evolve to their own Buddhahood, all of them, even the cockroach. And so you're just as, that's just as present to you as the present is when they are going to do that with your help. But you are going to be helping them. They, you know, as I said, otherwise they could waste their time cockroaching around infinitely too. I mean, infinity has no, it's not fate. It has no, infinity has no no determining role or function. It's just a space, like a space or a time in which things can happen. Eternity, eternal infinity. But what determines is your love and compassion and your skill and your interaction with them, your art. You're creating a situation in which they will finally figure it out. You get it? You get that? So therefore, when you become a bodhisattva, you sign up for that, you join that team, and then you're really capable, you become the capable bodhisattva as a Buddha. Because you realize that you already have all the equipment and all the knowledge that you need. because you become conscious of the infinite, your infinite energy of your clear light, supposedly. And even in the Kala Chakra, because you know, I'm mixing the two, you know, anyway. Some people came for Kala Chakra, don't be discouraged. In the Kala Chakra, I told you, I think I told you, but I was amazed in editing the Vimala Prabha, which means the stainless light, fifth chapter, which is perfection stage chapter. And Pundarika is the eighth king of Shambhala, supposedly. Pundarika means a white lotus. And he wrote a commentary on the short version of the Tantra, which is the only one we have, which was created by his father, who was a Manjushri, Yashas, the seventh king, and then who asked him to make a commentary on it called Vimala Prabha. And he said he's supposed to be incarnation of Avalokiteshvara, this Pundarika guy. So on one verse, verse 127 of that fifth chapter, he spends 47 Sanskrit pages, which is like 80-some English pages, arguing relentlessly that a Buddha has no atoms in a Buddha's body. Buddha's body is non-atomic. But it doesn't mean it's not energetic, so it doesn't mean it's non-material, because at that level, there's no difference between mind and matter. So they're not Vijnanavadins, although Kalachakra's face, one of his faces is ready to teach Vijnanavada, you know, the mind-only school. One of his faces is ready to teach Hinayana, two different versions of Hinayana, of, you know, Theravada, dualistic Buddhism. And only the front face teaches Madhyamaka, you know, just to show that it's like all of the different views are useful. And even the non-Buddhist views, as Vimalakirti said, the enlightenment of Buddha is to be found in every kind of view, every human view that there is. I guess that goes for Republicans. I can't believe it, though. Anyway, sorry, everyone. It's just the season, you know. So that means that a Buddha actually is one who designs himself and a world and the environment, but cannot redesign other beings. They have to do it themselves, but designs everything else to maximize beings' evolutionary progress to enlightenment. That's what it means, as a sort of wave force, you know, like a subatomic wave force. It's kind of fun. It's kind of a really interesting way of thinking about it, I think. And that Pundarika, by the way, I think Dalai Lama and that Pundarika are one incarnation line, although they never say that, Tibetans. Because why do you explain his complete obsession with the Kala Chakra Tantra? No Dalai Lamas have ever done more than once or twice in their lifetime a Kala Chakra initiation. He's up to number 34 or something, you know, and he's really into it. And he loves doing it, actually. It's tiring when he's not feeling well, but he does love doing it. It's really, and he doesn't skimp at all. That long thing you read, Kim, you read the long sadhana? He does that in Tibetan, and all there's so many Sanskrit syllables in it, you know, the ka 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 cha 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 cha. It's really hard to recite it. And he does that like in one day of that initiation, and then in the 8 to 10 days preparing, he goes through that like 4 or 5 times. And then there's a self-initiation, which is equally long, where he goes through the initiation, like initiating himself and the people and the monks who are doing it. So he goes through that many times with visualization and so on. All the offerings he does are really, there's whole special scripts about the whole offerings that are really elaborate, you know, with 8 conch shells made of silver pouring milk and et cetera, et cetera. It's amazing, actually. And he just completely does it because by doing all of that, then it makes it much more auspicious for all those who receive the blessing, mostly just receiving the blessing, because mostly the people don't really know what they're doing about it. So that's the thing. You know, this is really helpful too. You see, I like this Australian artist who drew this because this helps you visualize. And you know, those of us who are getting older and we have aches and pains and we have, you know, our body is kind of like doesn't really do everything we want it to do or feel like we want it to feel all the time, so on. So if we imagine, you know, like when we're sitting quietly somewhere or something, we sort of think about that there's this central channel and the right and left and the little knots, and then even we've imagined that the knots unravel themselves, and in a sort of a little bit magic way, they don't break anything, but they just unravel. And then they're like three little balloons, you know, like those long hot dog balloons that they make dogs and cats out of, you know. Jeff Koons makes the zillion-dollar metal sculptures shaping out like balloons like that. But these are these long balloons, a red one, a white one, and a blue one, red inside and blue outside, and that the energy is kind of there, and in the center of the heart level of that energy, there is your super subtle energy, and then the miracle world comes through that to you. You know, this Buddha world comes from the microverse, the micro Buddhist universes in there come through there, and then there's a thing where you mentally imagine like a tractor beam comes from there, and where you have an ache in your knee, it's like a nerve impulse, energy impulse coming from some blockage of some kind, and the tractor beam goes out and it pulls that, what's causing that pain, pulls that blockage and pulls it into the infinity in the center of your heart, and it sort of combs your nervous system free of blocks and obstructions and things like that. And you sort of, you know, subliminally affirm yourself as, you know, your subtle body self and your super subtle body mind as more in control of your coarse body mind. And therefore, kind of like overlaying it with a network of positive energy, something like that. Getting used to doing that. You know, just, you know, like when you're just snoozing or when you're just relaxing, just sort of revert to that, you know, default to that kind of thinking. I think it helps. I think it really helps a lot. And it's good. It's a good practice. So the better, more you learn about, like this is a medical one. The medical ones are, you know, a little different. I'm sorry you can't see it so clearly because of the light here. But and then this is which is from 17th century, really beautifully done. But it connects to acupuncture points and things like that, you know, that way of doing it. And then this is the yogic one. You see, that's the tube of the central channel, presented as a simple tube, although at it comes to your crown, and then there's a front loop that goes down to the middle of forehead. And in the base, from the perineum, there's another loop at the bottom that goes to the genital tip, either male or female. And then these are the different chakras. You know, the heart chakra is the one on this, that's the navel chakra, 64. It has 64 sort of outflow, things that come out, 64 navel chakra. That's the heart chakra, there's only 8. And then the brain chakra is 32, and the throat chakra is 16. And you see the way they're looped around, the red and white ones? You see, this one has the red on the right is as you look at it, rather than looking at you. And the white one is the left. And then at these different places, they're looped around like that. So when you visualize them, though, you visualize them as unlooping without having to pull through the central channel. Because it is software, so you just magically unloop it. And you have them just going straight down. And there's this great nine-point breathing that you do. Do you know the nine-point breathing? Anybody know that nine-point breathing? It's a very good one. Dr. Nida teaches it very well up at Menla, but when he comes over in Europe, when he's there. And that's where you inhale through the right nostril, closing the left with one finger like this. And you inhale through the right nostril and imagine it goes up the red channel and up to the crown and then down the red channel next to the central channel, and then that red channel fits like a pipe fitting below the navel into the white channel, but you hold it locked in the left and the right channel. You hold the breath a little bit, and then you move your finger to the right side, and then you exhale slowly from the left channel. And you feel that energy comes back up through the left channel and then comes out, crown of head, and goes down out like that. And you do that 3 times. And then you do the opposite three times. The left, two, three, and out the right. And then you do both of them, and then you plug them in your mind, like a pipe fitting, the two pipes coming down like this, and then fitting into the blue central channel. And then you exhale through both, but thinking that when you inhale, they went to the right and left, and then when you exhale, they come up through the center and they go out. And that's good, very clear, balancing breathing. That's really very, very good, and has a nice hand gesture with it, you know. That's very, very good. But you want to try that? Do people want to try it? You want to do it? Okay. So you can stay in the chair. Okay, so first you... Actually, there's ways of going where you go like this, and I'm not going to do all that. You just put one finger here, and then you inhale through the right nostril, imagining that the inhalation goes up to your crown, and then down the red channel, all the way to the above the sort of the hara, you know, like four fingers below the navel, above the perineum, but back near the coccyx, you know, not in the front, but in the back. And there it meets, in the middle, it meets the white channel, which goes up there, but you hold the breath just in the red one. And actually, as you hold it a little bit, you imagine that any kinks in the balloon, you know, in the straw or the balloon, the red straw, the balloon, sort of anything from it having been wrapped for a long time, they kind of release, and it becomes like smooth and clear, the red channel. And then you move the finger to the right. Actually, you should probably do it with the left. You move the finger to the left hand, but we'll just do it easy way. Move it to the right, and then slowly bring the breath up the white channel to the crown, and then down out the left nostril. Okay? And then you repeat that. You again move your finger here, and you repeat that again. Hold. Up and out the white left channel. And then third time, you inhale, opening the red one up. Hold. Then out the white one to the left. Then you inhale through the left, do the same thing three times. Imagine the left one is opening any kinks. Then out through the right. Then again. Then out through the right. Then again. Then out through the right. Now through both, inhale, slowly, gently. Hold in the left and right. Then plugged into the central channel, slowly out, up through the central channel, imagining that kinks in the central channel are released. And then out, then when the central channel gets to the mid-forehead, the wind moves and goes into the two right and left nostrils and comes out. And then three times. Okay, don't pass out now. There, it's good to learn it with the different hand gestures and things like that too. And it's just introducing you to the idea and to the idea of visualizing this kind of a tube in your body. I don't. There's some other great ones the Australian guy did, and you can imagine the different. You know, you can learn like the brain has a 30, there's no fixed number, but in the most of the unexcelled yoga tantras, like the brain has 32 petals, you know, actually go back to that one. So the brain has the 32 petals, it's that one. And those are just nerve fibers. They're made to look like nerve fibers. It's Tibetan's own drawing. You could draw lotus petals around them, you know, but that's the 32 petal thing that's actually depicted by that. And it's like an umbrella, which is kind of like your cortex, I think, sort of. And there's a great thing where once you get more aware of having a central channel, or you're programming yourself by visualizing it, and then you sort of imagine that your subtle consciousness goes up and goes into the center of those, of like a central kind of little tower room, and then looks down the 32 lines, you know, to the openings of the things, and like smooths the nerve endings and feels the flow, their openness to flow, you know, and removes kinks and cranks by sort of looking around there. It just becomes a point of awareness. It even goes out into the 32 petals and you sort of count them and so on. Then you go down in the throat, you have 16 that face upward, like a reverted umbrella, and you do the same. Then you go to the heart and you have the 8. And then the navel is 64, and you get where you really feel like you can feel that. It has a great, it's very wonderful, actually. You sort of work on learning to visualize that. It's really quite marvelous. Okay, so so now Cakrasamvara. Now within that, now the Guhya Samaja that we talked about is where you sort of learn about kind of like the setup. And then you get a very strong desire in that, by learning about that setup, to really do a visualization sadhana. Well, first you have to get an initiation from a responsible teacher, and then you learn to do a visualization sadhana. Because that visualization is where you develop a kind of ability in order to do that visualization sadhana. And the visualization sadhana is not just reciting or memorizing and then reciting, like, now you have so many hands and you're holding this in that hand, the other hand. That's what the sadhanas are. As texts, that's what they are. But and then now you melt down this way and now you rise again that way. It's like a whole performance, actually. But it's the visualization of it that's the main thing, not just the recitation. They make a big point out of that. And the purpose of that visualization is so that you can really imagine yourself having a different kind of a body and a nervous system. And if you think about it, at first you think, that's ridiculous, I can never really do that. But then, you know, meditate right now, for example. Just meditate now. Let's do that, for example. Let's meditate right now and visualize yourself as yourself. Let's try it. In other words, I'm sitting here, right? Now, I have a picture of myself as having 2 hands and 10 and 8 fingers and 2 thumbs and legs and toes, shoulders and skeleton and sense organs and my face and my skin and everything and my bones inside and, you know, nerves and bloodstream and heart beating, et cetera, et cetera. I have a whole picture of all of that. But actually, if I sit here now, I have to imagine my arm. I can wriggle my shoulder like this and feel like a sensation against my shirt on the skin. And maybe if I move the joint, you know, I can sort of get a sense of the bone, the upper arm bone, and then the elbow, I bump the elbow on something. But otherwise, what is your feeling of having these arms that are now folded in your lap because you're meditating? In a way, you're imagining them, aren't you? You're imagining, I, Bob, have 2 arms that are the arms that I looked, what they looked like last time I looked at them. Right? Because I don't really feel like that. You know, you don't feel the whole arm. On the other hand, if someone amputated your arm, you would go around for a while still feeling the arm, to the extent that you do, which means that you have an image in your brain of having this such and such an arm. So you're actually visualizing yourself all the time. So your imagination is routinized and tied up in maintaining whatever you think, you know, is the picture of yourself, your physical self, and your environment and everything, actually. So that's why for Tantra you have to have some understanding of emptiness / relativity, meaning that, you know, like a chair or a floor or the table or a pillar or the hand or something, any object, is not just whatever our picture of it is. It's actually empty of being fixated by the picture that we have of it or the concept that we have of it. It's empty of that concept matching an essence in it, right? Which, you know, that's what emptiness means. It doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It's a relational thing that's constantly changing. And it's inconceivable, like your hand is totally inconceivable. You know, even you look, it's different in different times and it looks in different angles and a different thing. But then inside there's all these atoms and inside the atoms are electrons and things and wave particle paradox is happening and double slot experiment is happening in every digit. And nobody knows what it is and you don't either. But you're visualizing, so you're imagining it as fitting with your idea of your hand. And when you unimagine that, or you critically separate the reality of your hand from what you imagined, then your imagination becomes more free. And actually what you do is you become aware that you are imagining the thing, rather than just thinking it's what it's there, you know. And this gives you more sense of responsibility about how you imagine yourself and how you imagine even something that normally requires no comment because you assume it's what it always has seemed to be, right? So what Tantra is doing, that's why I say it's Buddhist neuroscience, it's going down into these areas where you have a phantom limb. In a way, you have a phantom body right now in your brain. And very possibly that phantom body, when you send a motor impulse, with which you don't realize you're sending, you just think, you just move your hand, you know. You don't realize you're sending an impulse. The brain is making a plan and telling muscles and nerves to do something and moving the hand, right? Because it happens so fast, you know. And, or even some of these experimental psychologists will say that we don't even do it, the brain does it or something. They have all these kind of statements. But it channels those, it's able to send those things because it has a map, a model in the mind of what your body is. And it sends them through that model. And that's probably why in sort of old ancient times, in different cultures, you know, they had Western, Eastern, and different kind, they had little homunculi idea theories, you know. That there was a little you inside you, you know. But that homunculi made a way, it was your brain programming, in a way, it was your image. It was their kind of imagining or thinking that about the image that actually is in the brain of the ordinary person. So, sort of involuntarily there, you know. And so, the creation stage is where you recreate yourself in a body with certain attributes like limbs and colors and things that somehow suit you, you're gravitate toward, or they have an impact in your nervous system's programming. And you get to where, and you wouldn't have enough imagination to do that if you weren't aware that, in a way, you didn't have a kind of measure of uncertainty about what it is you do, what you are, actually. You're sort of open to being something other than what you have assumed yourself to be, what you're programmed to be by your education, by your parents, by all sorts of things, much more than by some genes or something, actually. And so you have to have that loosening of your imprisonment in a world of concepts that you have been indoctrinated and educated into. Inducated into, maybe I should say. You know, that the world is this and that, and I am such and such. And reinforced, of course, by lots of things, but and we reinforce each other in our conceptualized roles and whatever it is. So that loosened by the emptiness thing, and it is considered unsafe to practice these more subtle things dealing with the nervous system until one is aware that whatever one is what one makes of oneself. And then, and one has to also, and one also has to have a degree of mental stability to be able to stay concentrated on one thing for some period of time, to sort of and memorize something and then hold it in mind, you know, in detail, and then sort of feel it, you know. Like imagine even you had six arms, what would the shoulder joint feel like? What would the fingers feel like? And then they were holding certain things, and what would that feel like? And that's why this the Tibetan art, which is based on a huge Indian art, certainly, that has unfortunately all been destroyed. There's not hardly a single Indian cloth painting, like a Tanka painting, that they must have had millions of them in India. They're all totally destroyed in the second millennium. So we don't really have them. But we have the Tibetan ones are, you know, the offshoot of that. So they're more refined maybe in some respects, but they are that, you know. So the reason for having to do that, which Tom Yarnall's book is about, his translation of Tsongkhapa's 11th and 12th chapters of his Great Stages of the Mantric Path, is about the creation stage and why it's so necessary. And so every single thing that you do, like if you, any kind of one of those weird bodies that you might imagine yourself as having, if you successfully can visualize yourself as having such a body, shifting your brain model of yourself into that other model, then when you're in these subtle states, like dreamlike states, or meditational dream-like states, meditationally developed dream state, you then can shape your energy body into an ideal vehicle for what you're trying to understand or what you're trying to experience, for your, you know, to courageously and be unafraid of melting, for example, and able to experience internally in the petals of these inner chakras bliss that normally we only taste a tiny fragment of in the orgasm experience, usually. Occasionally some other kind of experience in some other part of the nervous system, but usually it's all genitally organized in the ordinary person. And so, you know, there's this whole thing about tantric sex, and the Cakrasamvara, the mother tantras particularly, have led to a lot of confusion about it, and actually not just Westerners. Some Tibetans have abused the whole thing about how sexuality is part of it, to go and jump on a bunch of girls here and there in a most disgraceful manner. And they get in trouble about it, as they should. The Dalai Lama advised people, and they hide behind, they tell you crazy wisdom, I'm a psychonaut and I can do this. And meanwhile, they're grossly overweight and they ride around in BMWs and they're not living in a burning ground with a loincloth and long weird hair and eating like strange food and really being yogis and dying a million times a night every night. They're not true psychonauts. They're making like Dharma empires, organizations and things like that. And it's a disgrace. And they're not only Tibetans, and there's Zen people who do it. There's swamis who do it. And it's wrong, completely wrong. And what these people are, they're taking these forms and they're thinking it's just something that ordinary people do. But this is not an excuse to go and behave in some ordinary way. And by the way, ancient India, it's not Tibetan's fault either, it's Indian's fault. This all comes from India. And ancient India didn't have to have a tantric excuse to have an orgy. They have the Kama Sutra. Do you know what I mean? They know how to party. They were partying thousands of years before Masters and Johnson, or whatever. You know, I always jokingly like to say that the Indian Masters and Johnson occurred in the second century of the Common Era. They weren't so freaked out as the Europeans, you know, or even the Chinese. You know, and so these are this is this kind of deep, unconscious erotic energy, but not any kind of ordinary sexuality at all. Not at all. It's some kind of really strange yoga. It's an athletic thing, you know. And by the way, both parties have to be at the same level or it can't work out. That makes it really difficult. In other words, a lot of the scholars who like to sneer about the Tantra, in my colleagues, you know, and they write all kinds of things, and they think these psychonauts are people who want to go and like slurp on strange juices. They do. They think that's the main thing. Well, they want that they're going to get immortal by going and eating some semen or some menstrual blood or whatever they go. They're just nuts to be so rude to these great yogis, you know. They're not at all interested in such things. That's ridiculous. What it is they're trying to open these chakras, you know, these things. You know, the 64 petals, it's at the navel. It isn't even where the genitalia are. It's at the navel. Now try to have an orgasm in that chakra, meaning let those nerves completely open and completely melt and generate bliss, you know. That's what they're talking about. The ultimate one is, in Hindu tantra, they tend to think the ultimate one is the brain chakra. They're all into blowing the brain thing because they want to become gods, you know. But Shiva, you know, they want to become Shiva. But in the Buddhist thing, there can be a big bliss in the brain, yes, and in the throat too. But the big one is the heart. The heart chakra is the most important, although it's piddling 8 petals, but apparently that's enough because somehow it's not only 8, actually. Each of the 8 is branches into 3. So there's actually 24, and they're red, white, and blue again, like the 3 channels, and it's a far out thing. The heart chakra. Cakrasamvara, especially about the heart chakra. It's and Guhya Samaja both. They both are. So that's why Tsongkhapa rejected the idea that Guhya Samaja father and others are father tantras, and Cakrasamvara is the mother tantra. You know, clear light emphasis, in other words, and father tantra, magic body emphasis, because the union or communion, as I translated, of the highest level of the 5. Perfection stages in the Tantra is the union of the magic body and clear light, male and female, bliss and void, and so on. And so he said, and then the Kalachakra is the non-dual Tantra, neither father nor mother, but non-dual. But he rejected that. He said all of the unexcelled yoga Tantras are non-dual, and it's just an emphasis in the Guhya Samaja, emphasis in the Cakrasamvara, but they're really the same. He Vajra, Hayagriva, etc., all of them, Yamanteka, they're all the same. But they're different emphases for people who are different aptitudes and inclinations, just like any other thing, like, you know, for like a pharmacopoeia of visualization, you could say, of neurology, of neuroscience. And Kala Chakra is in the Mother Tantra side because it so much develops the inner chakras. And it actually, the Kala Chakra has a unique thing where it doesn't use a magic body. It sort of transmutes the body in place, the coarse body. So it's something completely different, which we'll talk about more next time. It has a different thing, and it's very interconnected also with the Shaivites because of its history, you know, to appeal to them, and really it has all the Hindu gods in it, 722 deities. It's really quite a menagerie in the Kala Chakra. Okay, so that yes. Yes. Yes.
So I've heard Tom Yarnell speak about the syllables at the chakras.
Yes.
And that there's, unfortunately, I missed the second part of the lecture, so he said, oh, I'll talk about that next time. I never heard why they were so important.
Yeah.
That's the first part of my question, but I've also heard, like Joe will replace, I think.
The what?
I think my understanding is that Joe will replace these syllables with like an exclamation point. So what is the importance of
the exclamation, something like an exclamation point is called the short hung. You know, which or no, short ah, that's right, short ah, which has to do with some dumo type of meditation, which can be used, you know. So it doesn't really, it's not that this or that syllable is the only thing that you can do.
Oh, okay.
What it is that if you can hold your mind stably at some point within the nerve, if you develop a map of your own subtle nervous system, not super subtle, it's not a nervous system, but the subtle nervous system, if you develop a map of it that somehow fits into your own physiology, and then you put your mind in a point in that map, putting the mind there will have will move energy to it. You know, visualizing it moves energy to that point. Like our beloved Bill Bichel, you know, the archivist of all the articles. People have done experiments in labs in University of Ohio State and different weird things. Like if someone puts their mind and holds it on a point on their palm, they then measure a temperature differential by holding their mind. So there's been some sort of certain people who are not like fanatic materialists have actually been testing these things out. So that's really what it is, you know, the letters and the different things. But there's some auspiciousness about om, ah, hum, you know, in the brain, throat, and heart, for example. Swaha, you know, for example, if you do all five, in the om, ah, hum, swaha, you know, there's another way to do it, or ha, ho, ri, there's other things in Tantra, in Kalachakra, they have other syllables. So it's not like the one syllable has to just be like this, and it can only look like that and the other. There are just different things that are developed that have auspiciousness that people have used before. And there is a short ah thing that it bursts into flame in Dumo, which comes from that letter ah, you know, which then which looks like that, you know, like a little thing like that in Tibetan, like that, and then they just simplify it into just what looks like an exclamation point. You know, it's a sort of simple thing because it's meant to burst into flame. Because the real Dumo is supposed to be just an inner flame inside the central channel, not heating your whole body, actually. When you do a thing, you can just hold your breath and heat your body. I don't know, do you ever have a mountaineer do that? If you're wearing a wool sweater or even a cotton t-shirt and someone comes and blows on your back, it can almost be so hot it stings. You know, there's a lot of heat in the body, you know. So Dumo is not just about making the body hot, although it was a good byproduct that Milarepa could live in the hills, in the Kailash in the winter, you know, naked. But that was a byproduct. But the main thing is to have a fire, a flame like it's like natural gas, you know. It's not a coal flame, it's natural gas. And it goes up the central channel, melts, it's meant to melt the neurotransmitters, you know, in the brain, you know, and to make them flow in the system. So, then, you know, in this area, this advanced area where the psychonauts are, there are actually angels who get involved and who show up, who are not normally human. And, you know, one goes on long retreats and they show up and they teach people, they do things, and they punish people who behave badly, actually. And they guard the secrecy of things. They are such beings. Dakinis, you know. Jung's anima, you know. Carl Jung's anima. But it's not just a mental fantasy. They really do exist. And they're female, they're enlightened beings. There are also worldly dakinis who one has to be a little cautious about. You know, but there are these extraordinary ones. Definitely. I can swear to it. And any other question? Yes, Banu.
As far as I understood, the very subtle mind is the mind that realizes the voidness of things.
Yes.
And I couldn't understand what experience does the subtle mind has? Like, it doesn't see voidness? Like,
the subtle mind does, in the sense that the subtle mind are these three void states, seeming voids, like vast states, moonlit, sunlit, and darklit. That's the subtle mind. The super subtle mind Yeah, but the super subtle mind is bliss itself. So it's bliss realizing voidness, which is at first seems like an odd thing. How can bliss know voidness? How can bliss be a subjectivity that knows voidness in a way, you know? So bliss, bliss knows voidness means, I think, that bliss sort of melts one away from structures. You know, you think bliss melts you. And then that bliss, knowing voidness, then is able to completely melt. And so there's a bliss voidness experience of sleep. There's a bliss void experience of death. There's a bliss void experience of orgasm. These are the deepest, you know, the ordinary in ordinary life. Those are the normal deep ones. And the bliss void thing of yoginada then is one that is control all of those, you know. And dying is inconvenient, you know. Then you have to be reborn. So that's where to take the bliss of ordinary orgasm, which is so partial compared to the whole nervous system, rather than just what Freud called genitally organized, or Wilhelm Reich also called genitally organized. It's so small compared to but it's a metaphor almost, it's an analogy. It's a gateway for the larger one, which is the whole system. And which is why ordinary, some fake guru who grabs some female and rushes off and says, now we're going to have a big initiation or something, or you're going to serve and gain enlightenment, or is told BS, because both people have to have the open nervous system where it's in the head and the heart and the throat. It's not just some pumping stuff, you know. Might be part of it, but that's not it. And also the whole, you know, what they call seminal retention. But not seminal retention by clamping off sensation. Seminal retention, totally melting, letting it all go, and yet not emitting anything. Try it. Try that. One of those lamas, what they're doing, you know. They're not able to do that. So it's all BS if someone can't do that. Then they're not supposed to, it's just regular sex, and it's an excuse for it, and it's fake. But if they have the ability, then it is. Then sometimes there are things where there is, you know, a couple is involved, but both have to know about it, what it is, and both have to have all the prerequisites, the certain level of detachment, not to go nuts, the compassion thing, not to sort of veer off onto power trips, and the wisdom thing, you know. To be aware that it's voidness that they're experiencing, that their bliss is melting into, which is infinite, you know, not some specific organized biological function, if you follow me. So what's so beautiful is the madhyama, the word madhyamaka, and the middle way, you know, central. I prefer central because it's central channel. But finally, that's the only way one fully can understand emptiness, which is why one doesn't really understand emptiness. One just melts into it. And there's no possession of that experience, actually. One has to just give oneself to that experience completely. And therefore, someone who says, I realize it, I know it, it's a nonsense. In a way, okay, well, they had some experience, but they don't own that experience. It owns them, actually. And the voidness owns you only when you're owned by voidness. All you can do is be compassionate and non-harmful to anybody. You're not the reason that Manjushri overwhelms Yama. You know, they had these, you know, god battles, you know, like the famous Yamantaka thing. The reason that he does is because he is not opposing Yama, he is one with Yama. And so to teach Yama not to be separate, he can reflect a million Yamas to Yama, if you follow me. So Yama is confronted by like infinite Yamas, and then he doesn't go around killing people anymore, you know. Yama is the Indian god of death, right? But he doesn't do it because he's somehow bigger than Yama. He is, the only way you can be bigger than some deity like that is to also be the deity. And therefore, there's no opposition. The deity melts right into you, you know. And then realizes, oh, wow, that's different. Emptiness is like that. That's why they say, beginning of Tsongkhapa's book, he says, Shambhu Megavahana Hiranyagarbha Damodara and Anangapati. When they see you, they melt like fireflies in the sun. Remember that? In that book that you study. Remember that? Well, why do they feel like, what? You what? You didn't memorize it? Come on. What? Another question. So I'm so happy to clear. I'm going to give a talk in Norway. If I don't show up this fall, if I don't survive, I'm giving a talk in Norway to the worldwide academics in one of those kind of conference, International Association of Tibetan Studies. And I'm going to explain what this thing is in the Cakrasamvara Tantra, where they say take a 12-year-old girl and this and that, you know. And like they just still do in Nepal, secretly, you know, the Newars, they have these kumaris, you know, these goddesses, these small girls, you know. And that's nice thing. The other horrible Nepalis are like selling their daughters to brothels in Calcutta. And in those cultures, all these kind of things happen, you know. So they're acting like, oh, that's so terrible. The 15-year-old or 12-year-old girl becomes a yogini and becomes a queen in some special culture of some high-level people. Well, they're freaking out. That's so evil. What's evil about it? Even on this planet, there's one guy who works in the UN, an Italian guy, who released a figure which I haven't heard lately. I think he's somebody else in his job, you know, dealing with slavery and global sex slavery. It's like millions of people, millions, right now, being marketed around town, London, here, everywhere. You know, the human beings are not behaving that nicely, generally. So the idea that there would be some yoginis, it's, you know, it's like saving someone from something, probably, in some ancient time, you know. So they get all in a rage about it, and then, oh, Tantra's so evil, and they go like this, they do. They're called scholars, as a way of proving that every other world tradition is just as bad as the Western ones. That's one of their main objectives. It is in academia. It's one of the main objectives. They, you know, they have the, like, they're so thrilled that the bad monks in Burma are chasing some Muslims in a horrible manner. Really, it is horrible. They're quite right. But they're thrilled about it. You know, they write books immediately. Oh, those Buddhists are so terrible. I heard a Muslim scholar from California at the Center of Council on Foreign Relations just throw offhand a comment. He said, oh, the most vicious religion on the planet is the Buddhists. It's like a Muslim mullah. And he's saying the Buddhists are the most vicious people on the planet? I mean, if he said the Christians were, I wouldn't blame him. But the Buddhists? The Buddhists? It's like cuckoo. Christians and himself, you know. But everyone let it pass, you know. It was a context where I couldn't protest, you know. And my Tibetan friend who was with me also couldn't protest. Extraordinary, I thought. Because they're just thrilled about it, you know, because they don't want to clean up their own act. Anyway, I'm going to give a talk to them. So I might be burned at the stake in Norway after being doused with fish oil on the coast of Norway. Yes.
Yeah, hi. I had a question. I was wondering if you felt like commenting on highest yoga tantra.
I don't call it highest.
Ah.
Unexcelled yoga tantra.
Yes. And particularly
not highest. Please don't call it highest. That's a bad translation.
Isn't it called translated sometimes as
that's
highest
a bad yoga? Translation.
Okay, cool.
It's anuttara. Mm. It means you can't get beyond it.
Yes.
It doesn't mean highest in some snobby way.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Like in a hierarchy. It means it's at the heart of everything.
Yeah.
And once you reach there, you can't leave, you know. I like to say it means it's like tar baby. If you know what that is, maybe you don't know about pogo. It's tar baby. But go ahead. Yes, what about it?
So
I'm sorry.
Here's the question. I'm very interested in your reflections on the visceral experience of, you know, the Great Seal of Kala Chakra is it Dharmakaya? Is it experiencing Dharmakaya in while still alive? And a few classes ago, you had talked briefly about it. You had said, you described it very well as the universe exploding in your head. And for myself, I've often wondered
the universe is floating where?
In your head.
Oh.
You know, where...
Well, your head is also floating in the universe, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
Well.
I've often thought that it's a glimpse of the Big Bang, you know, in the first Planck, the universe, and the first Planck lengths of existence. I'm very interested to see what you think about the, you know, the actual experience of the gracie of Kala Chakra. And you'd also said, don't work magic with it. And I was like...
Don't what?
You had said, don't work magic with it.
Work magic?
Yes, yeah.
With me?
Yes. Several classes ago, you had said it. Yes.
What was that about? I have no idea.
I thought it was a very interesting statement. And you had talked briefly about how, you know, one can go mad by experiencing, you know, this visionary practice.
From the Buddhist point of view, the unenlightened person is insane. You know, enlightenment is not madness, it's sanity. But as Milarepa said, sometimes people who live by the Dharma, they are thought of as mad by the ordinary people, whereas they think that ordinary people are mad, because the ordinary people are just going from birth to death without like seeing to their final destiny and without like using their precious human life to save themselves from all kinds of future lives of suffering and so on. So they're doing things that they, in order to be happy, they're doing things that are going to make them miserable, so they seem insane to a Dharma person. Milarepa said that. I don't remember what our previous conversation was, and I have said, and we do have to imagine what Buddhahood is, not just Kala Chakra, but Buddhahood. You know, Kala Chakra, Cakrasamvara, these are just tools to accelerate a vast evolution to Buddhahood, physical as well as mental, into a smaller time frame, you know, by compressing time by entering a subtle plane, something like that. That's what Tantra really is. And it's because I was saying that, it's like at the beginning, it's like a bodhisattva is happy to spend infinite lifetimes becoming a Buddha. But once they get to where they can taste it a little bit, they're not happy to have other beings, their other mother beings, other beings who they think are their mothers, to wait for them to be able to be skillful enough to really help them maximally. And, you know, they can sort of rationalize and sit back. Tsongkhapa says in the Ngarim Chemo, this sort of old salt type thing. It's like, oh, well, the other Buddhas are really working on it. Why should I work myself up? You know, there's lots of Buddhas, so they're all working on everybody, so everything will be fine. I don't have to really sweat it. But the bodhisattva, when they reach a certain point, they get, well, the other Buddhas may be working, but they seem to have, they haven't really reached Trump Tower yet, quite. They're not really like on the 53rd floor of Trump Tower, like telling those people to like get out there and noblesse oblige, you know. And so I'm going to be one of them. I'm going to see to it that the people that I see that I don't think are being helped enough are getting helped, and I'm going to accelerate my ability to do that. And then it's like in a dream. You know, you could have a dream, and technically, you could have a lucid dream where you could die 10 times in a night in a situation where the death process was where you had to give your life to somebody. You could do that in a dream, and then wake up, and you wouldn't have to be reborn and go back to school and high school and college and meet Buddhism and be a bodhisattva vow and whatever. You could gain the what they call the merit of giving your life or giving something precious to you in a dream 10 times, 20 times over. And it would, because it was a dream, in a way you would be able to do that without having to go through the whole physiological, biological process of dying and being reborn. So then you think of 1,000 times in a night, 1,000,000 times in a day or in a week, in a month, in a year, you know, and you're really changing your whole relationship to the universe, you follow me. Now, you mentioned Big Bang. The Big Bang is kind of pretty much our militarized Western society fantasy that there was some sort of Big Bang, you know. I think that in the Sanskrit universe, Hindu as well as Buddhist, even Vedist, in between, in times of what they call pralaya, when the universe has dissolved, what's lying around are not atoms or subatomic energies or some sort of pent-up black hole things that are going to explode sometime. What is lying around are consonants and vowels that do not come together. They're disaggregated, and especially the vowels are missing. So the consonants are all lying around, and they cannot express anything. And there's, and you know, they have this thing that language creates the world. You know, in the beginning was the word. Well, these are the components of words, but they can't function. So what happens is the sound comes, which is the Brahma sound, and it picks up all these consonants and starts making language, and then mantra, and then things are created. And so it's a little smoother, you know, it's like turning up the volume in an audio, and then becomes video, rather than a big explosion, you know, which is kind of a militaristic society's fantasy of what God is there, is the big exploder. The Indians had that too. The Vajra, you know, that they call the Vajra? The Vajra was Indra's scepter that emanated thunderbolts, and he could split cities, and he could split dragons with it, you know. It was a weapon. It was the supreme weapon, Indra's weapon, the Vajra. And then it became for the Buddhists, and then the Buddhists sort of made the Hindus see it like that a little bit, that it's like love is what it is. The stronger force is love, not anger, ferocity, explosiveness, you know. So at the Big Bang, you know, it's a fantasy, you know, the Big Bang. A redshift, you know, all the planet, all the stars are running away from us. Oh, well, of course they are. We're polluting the place. They all want to run away. But they might come back, and it might be just somebody, we might be a tiny subatomic fragment in the lung of an old shaman who's living on a mountain in a different galaxy, on another universe, and he's inhaling slowly, and so it looks like everything's moving away, and then it'll all come back. You know, the standard model is like full of holes, black holes, and they don't know what to do about it, except Leonard Nimoy saved the whales with a black hole. Remember? So there are creative uses of it for nice people like Leonard Nimoy. Anyway.
I love what you just said about...
What's that?
I said, I love what you just said about inhaling, that we're just on this inhale or exhale.
Yeah.
Giant, how do we know we're not?
We are. You know that we were together. We read that Samantabhadra thing. I hope you went and got that book, and read those things now and then, because that Samantabhadra is in every atom. There's Buddha lands and universes in every atom of this one, in every subatomic particle. There's infinite numbers of them, and we are just one in some infinite particle. So, it's a wonderful vision. That is, it's really wonderful. Even just a little bit swimming in it, bathing in it. You know, putting it on at night, reading a paragraph, like putting on night cream or something, you know. Then you can go to sleep and feel happy.
I read a chapter to Michael and he thought it was...
You read a chapter to him?
To Michael.
Oh, good. Yes, yes.
That is interesting.
I know.
He didn't want to go on.
Tell him it's a 5-star universe. He'll like it. Okay, any other question? Yes, Matt. Matt, right? Wait, she's giving you a mic here.
Oh, yeah. All right, so you said that a lot of academics were a little skeptical. Were you talking about Tantra in general?
Yes.
Okay. So would you say that there's not many experiments going on with Tantra? I know meditation is all the rage now, but has that extended to Tantra as well for psychologists or...
Well, these are not that kind of scientific academic. These are Tibetan scholars.
Okay, got you.
But there's a whole bunch of them that are trying to like really use Tantra as a way of dumping on. But also, actually, in Indian culture today, people are scared of tantrics. You know, and it's like, oh, Tantra, no. And that's something weird, because there's also been so much abuse, like these lamas who have abused their students, you know. Well, we're going to let's go have some tantric sex. That's just BS. So sexual energy is very, very precious and valuable, but it is the matter of going off and it's not an excuse for rolling in the hay. People don't need an excuse for that. They do that anyway. You know, I think so. We have a population problem. So don't worry about that. As far as experiments go, you know, I think KGB and CIA are likely to make psychonaut experiments. But I think they didn't get too far, you know, because they kept... In the old days, they were all doing psychedelic experiments. And then they were trying to give soldiers, like, different psychedelic drugs, thinking they could become super killers. And then the soldiers just all lay down, like, wow, and started laughing, you know. And they were embracing the enemy, you know, and they can't have that happen. So that didn't work out. So they gave up on that. And then they do give them amphetamine and stuff like that to make them, like, nervous, you know. So, you know, they don't believe in these things, you know. So they don't experiment about it, you know. And it's not really necessary to do that kind of experiment. But I think Davidson and his group, the neuroscientists, will eventually get interested in the subtle nervous system. And instead of just meditating someone thinking compassion, which is itself very valuable, but still it's just a beginning thing, they will do different kinds of meditation and really get people working on that and measure what happens in the nervous system with that. I think that'll be useful. But of course, the most useful thing will be if the scientists themselves do these meditations and it becomes part of scientific training, where you learn to, you know, like emptiness meditation, if you do, and then, you know, this whole thing where they're so freaked out about quantum and you know, the string theory and 11 dimensions and, you know, keep following the holes in the theories of the standard, quote-unquote, standard model, and by trying to patch the holes by going into all these sort of sci-fi ideas that they can't really experiment about, which are really unscientific, they're really theological, practically. So if they did more emptiness meditation, I think they'd be more successful in doing that, actually. They'd use their math more. And eventually, I think it should be the training for a physicist or a biologist. Should be that sort of thing. I really do. But I thought it would happen in my lifetime when I was a young professor, young scholar. But the resistance is so huge, too much. You know, they're being stuck to the idea that we're so smart and we're the most advanced civilization that ever happened. And it's really big. I mean, it's all these campuses, you know, they're so triumphalist about it. It's incredible. Meanwhile, the evidence is that they're wrecking the entire planet in a speedily. And it's to producing more people to do so. Yes?
I wanted to ask you why you think the Tantra and Mahayana disappeared from the Theravada tradition?
I'm sorry?
Why Mahayana and Tantra disappeared?
Why Mahayana and Tantra?
Disappeared from the Theravada tradition?
Well, the Theravada tradition, I mean, the Theravada tradition is Mahayana. It's there in the Theravada tradition in a certain way. In other words, they're all integrated in each other. You know, they're like nested in each other. But the Theravada tradition is, in a way, Buddha taught for people who would be confused by things like non-dualism and would become discouraged about it. So it's like different things for different people who have different intellectual, mental, emotional abilities. There's a ladder for everyone. There's a rung on the ladder that everyone can get on. And Theravada, unfortunately, is for the people is for people who cannot conceive that the world is nirvana and that they have to proceed by removing their own ignorance about that nirvana. They are so sensitive about the world, and in some other way they are so narcissistic about their inner self that they suffer in the world. And yet they feel somehow in there's some grand place that's really marvelous. So he lets them feel, he urges them to feel that nirvana will be somewhere else, and it will be apart from this that's causing the suffering. And but what happens is that then they withdraw into this inner space, and then they discover that, and they're capable of dismissing this existence of all this, and they think that's a nirvana. But then they keep coming back here, and then they're feeling less and less intent about escaping. So then they're willing to tackle the situation, if you follow me. It's like the Buddha said, there are several analogies he gave in the Lotus Sutra to Shariputra, who said, well, why didn't you tell us that it's all fine to start with and we're already in nirvana and it's non-dual and all this? And he said, well, there's a captain, caravan driver who's leading a whole caravan across a desert. And they're getting very near the end of their supplies. And the people in the caravan, he becomes aware, they're plotting to assassinate him and turn back because they think he's lost. But they can never make it back to where they came from. They're already 4 weeks into the thing and they only have a few more days. And actually, he knows that the oasis is just a few more days. He knows that because he's not lost. But they're not believing him and they're rebelling and they're not moving. So he says, this caravan guy apparently has some sort of hypnotic or magician powers. So he creates a false oasis, one further day away that they can see. And then they see that, oh, great, and they run to the false oasis. But then when they get to the false oasis, he creates a vision for them. When they get to the false oasis, then, oh, there's no oasis here. There was a hallucination, and then they would really kill him. But he spaces it out where, from that, they can see the real one. So then he says, "Oh no, you don't have. Look, there it is. It really is there." You know, and then they make it to the real one. So that's one of his analogies. And he has another great one, where a doctor has some kind of medicines that are poisonous in his, you know, pharmacopoeia, but, you know, in tiny doses, they're helpful for certain conditions. And he has these children who are very naughty, and they break into his medicine cabinet when he's away on a trip, and they steal the medicines, and they eat them, and they get poisoned, and they become paranoid. And so when he comes back, he can't give them the antidote. He doesn't know how to do it, because they're frightened of him, and so on. So then what he does is he puts the antidote back in the cabinet and he locks it up and then he goes away again. They go and steal it again and then they cure themselves, you know. So there are lots of images. Then there's another great one about the mother. There's a mother whose infant has some strange disease and the doctor comes and says, I can cure the infant, but it's very crucial that you don't give any breast milk for 2 weeks while this medicine works its thing, just water. And then she says, but my breasts are overflowing, and he cries, and I can't stand it, and he wants only the milk, what can I do? And he says, okay, I'll tell you, and he gives her a paste. And the paste is a vile-smelling, vile-tasting thing to put on her nipples. And he says, okay, when the baby cries, just give it the nipple with this foul-smelling paste. And of course, the foul-smelling is suffering, you know, impermanence, you know, death, misery, whatever, you know, all the descriptions of suffering in the Theravada. And so then the baby will go like this and won't want to drink. So then you can be cool, you know. If your breast hurt, you can express it and throw it away or save it. So then the baby is healed and then she nurses it again. So he's saying that his teaching of the Mahayana is like mother's milk, of the Buddha's mother's milk. But some people can't digest it. And it'll poison them because they'll think, well, if it's all nirvana and I'm still suffering, then who needs nirvana? Forget it. This guy's an idiot. Or if it's all nirvana, I can do whatever I feel like and I can do even evil things. It won't matter because it's all nirvana. So someone will misunderstand the thing in that way. So for them, the Theravada. And I think particularly the Theravada target were mostly Brahmin males who were mostly into themselves. They were maybe a little narcissistic, let's say. Their mothers spoiled them a lot, or their fathers would beat them up, beat the mothers up if they didn't. And that's the way the family system was. And so they couldn't think of being blissfully enlightened, sitting around with all the untouchables and the non-twice-born people. And so they had to think there was some vast place waiting for them, the elite, that they would reach that was separate, you know. And then when they got there, what they were separated from was their narcissism, and then they were ready for the long evolution of the Mahayana, you know, bodhisattva path, my opinion. You know.
Thank you.
But on the other hand, I have a theory that actually nobody else agrees with me. Good night. Nobody else agrees with my theory. If you have studied more Buddhism, you know there's something called the four formless realms. And the Buddha specifically says those realms are not nirvana. But one of them is infinite space, infinite consciousness, absolute nothingness, and beyond consciousness and unconsciousness is the fourth one. And in a way, that's Turiya for most of the Hindus who think that the ultimate is near. They still think that nirvikalpa samadhi, just disappearing from everything, is the ultimate. You know, they still act like that. Because that's a natural escapist attitude that we have. But those four, if you align them with the three levels of the subtle body, you know, the three luminances, and then the fourth is the clear light. They are kind of hinted teachings of that, you know. But the idea is that you don't stay in those things. Those are just layers of your body. You become conscious of them, of your unconscious. The three luminances, by the way, also have 80 instinctual surges in them that the normal person, therefore, doesn't really see vast space of moonlight and sunlight and so forth, because they have different kinds of, like, surge, you know, instinctual surges. They want to grab something or do something, and so they don't notice they're in a vast space. They want to be defined as separate from things, so that they have these instinctual surges, and it's only the more when you become more and more conscious of your unconscious, or you're not victim of your instincts, you then see them as these spaces, you know. But those meditators reached something like those places in themselves, which are the formless realms. But then if they stick there, they become reborn as formless realm deities, which is a way station where they're stuck there, you see. He's teaching the subtle sort of cosmology of the tantras, actually, already in the Theravada. It's all there, you know. But, you know, as he said to them, he said, I have held nothing back from you. He says that in Theravada's Pali. I have not held anything back, you know. I have not had the closed fist of a bad teacher, he said. But on the other hand, what I've been able to share with you is like this fistful of leaves, and really the Dharma, my teachings are like this vast forest with all the leaves in the forest, he says. Buddha in the Theravada says. So there's all this stuff in the Theravada pointing to non-duality, pointing to that nirvana is not simply an escape and a disappearance, pointing to the compassion. Even he teaches all his former lives, 500, 5,000 former lives as bodhisattvas himself. But he just doesn't say to them, you have to do like that. You have to feed your body to the tiger. You have to be a woman. You have to be an animal. You have to do all this stuff. He doesn't say that, which Mahayana kind of bodhisattva thing says, yes, that's you all have to be bodhisattvas. You know. But he says, I was a bodhisattva, right? And says, I did all those things. So therefore, I'm a Buddha now. You guys are just our hats. But that's enough for you at the moment. Okay, cool. But hey, and then later, and there are some debates in India where the people who are saying, well, no, that's wrong. You know, Buddha doesn't have a body. Buddha disappeared into final nirvana. He's just left, you know. And that's what we're doing. We're leaving. And this nonsense that the Buddha has Dharmakaya Dharmakaya just means the books, the teaching, and that he has a sambhogakaya and he manifests and emanates, and that's ridiculous. And then you ask them, then the debates, they say, well, how come Buddha is able to do all that teaching and stuff and you guys can't do that? And they say, oh, he's luckier. He's lucky. He was lucky, they say. But they have no explanation for that. And they don't say, oh, bodhisattva, 500 bodhisattva lives, 1,000 bodhisattva lives, we're all going to do that. They don't say that. They don't want to face that. Okay? All right. I think that's it. I'm late. I got to go. I got to get up at 5 a.m. to go to San Francisco.